everybody. This is Brandon Cruz with Damon's Real Texas Barbecue again. This video we're going to do about making sausage. We make sausage here pretty much at least once a month. So I'm going to show y'all all the ins and outs, all the secrets that we do to make our sausage. So what we start out with, our sausage is half beef, half pork. This is brisket trimmings. Every time we trim a brisket here, we save all our trimmings and it goes into our sausage. So it makes it a lot cheaper than having to go and buy beef to make sausage. This here is pork butts. It's the only thing we usually have to buy when we do make sausage. Now we also, when we trim our ribs, we keep those trimmings as well, and they go into it as well. Now we don't add any beef fat or pork fat. Our briskets, we trim them because we save all the fat and make tallow and use that for our tortillas. So most of the fat has been taken off of this beef. As far as the pork butts, we don't trim them at all. We just cut them into chunks. What you have here is 50 pounds total, 25 pounds of beef, 25 pounds of pork. So I'm going to, here's my knife. Okay, so we're just going to mix this up. So that way you have a nice even pork and beef mixture. And you can tell how much fat is on this pork. And there's plenty. So there's no reason to add any fat. Get all your fat content for the sausage out of this pork. And you can see the beef is pretty much trimmed out, hardly any fat at all. A little bit, I mean, just from the marbling, because they're really high grade briskets, so. Okay. All right, I'm gonna change my gloves real quick. All right, so now we're gonna add our spices. So this is the spice we use. We've used this company forever, long before we ever opened a restaurant. I was using their sausage their seasonings to make our sausage. This is German style smoked sausage seasoning with the cure. It's made by REO Spices out of Huntsville, Texas. You can find them at www.reospice.com. They make all sorts of sausage seasoning. You name it, they have it. It's fantastic because they make 25-pound bags and 50-pound bags. It's a 50-pounder, so that means all you have to do is take 25 pounds of pork, 25 pounds of beef, add your seasoning to it. It even comes with the cure. You just mix that into a bowl and throw it on your meat, and it's perfectly done. It'll come out perfect every time. They are fantastic. Check them out. Usually anything over $50 is free shipping, and it's at your door within 2 days. They're fantastic. I get our casings from there. Anything dealing with sausage, I usually get from REO. So here we have in the bowl, we have our seasoning. This is the cure. So what you'll do is just add this straight to the seasoning. Now you can make sausage without cure, but I wouldn't recommend it. Now, if you're not gonna smoke it, then that's not a problem. But if you're gonna smoke it, you want to add your cure to your seasoning, because what the cure does is it kills any bacteria that could be growing in the meat while it's going through the smoking process. There are safe levels where you're supposed to keep meat at. Anything under 40 degrees or above 140. That area between those two is a danger zone. So if your meat is within that zone for more than 4 hours, that bacteria can grow and it can be harmful. By adding cure to your seasoning, that keeps that bacteria from growing, because if you do a cold smoke, the sausage will stay under 140 degrees for hours. until you're done smoking. So it may not even get to 140. You might pull it before it gets to 140, and that could be really dangerous if you don't have cure in your seasoning. So I advise, if you're smoking, always add cure. But if you're not going to smoke, what we call serve green sausage, where basically you stuff it and then freeze it right away, then you don't really need to add cure. When you do add that, it's going to turn your meat pink. It, no matter how long you cook that sausage, it'll always look pink. We do a sausage burger here that we don't smoke. What we do is we take this recipe, we turn it into beef patties, and then we throw them right on the grill. Now, I add cure to that because we call it a sausage burger. And to me, sausage is always pink because it always has cure. So naturally, I want it to be the same, the patties versus the links. So I add cure to it, even though it's not getting smoked. But okay, so now we've added our cure, and you're going to give it a good mix. You want this to be mixed thoroughly. Now, there is one thing that I do add to our this seasoning, and the reason for it, okay, so for years, this is exactly what I would do. I would throw this into my meat and start grinding. But one day, a friend of mine who has way more experience making sausage than me, he was like, "You want to add some mustard seed to it?" And I was like, "Sure, what does it do?" He said, "I don't know what it does." He said, "But man, it just gives that sausage a nice pop." So I tried it. Soon as I did, I fell in love with it. So that's what I have here. This is 3 ounces of mustard seed. So you do 6 ounces for every 100 pounds of meat. So this is half of that. This is 50 pounds. So this is 3 ounces of mustard seed. So we add that to our seasoning as well. Get that out of the way. Mix it up really well. So now we have our seasoning, our cure, our mustard seed. Now, a lot of people will grind all their meat and then mix their seasoning into it. I don't do that. To me, that's a lot harder. This is the simplest thing to do, is just before you grind, throw all your seasoning on your meat. We're just going to mix all of this seasoning into this meat. It's a whole lot easier to mix it when it's big chunks like this than it is when it's ground into basically hamburger. And as it goes through this grinder, it's going to mix beef and pork, seasoning, everything into it. Now, if you were making jalapeno cheese sausage right now, which this sausage is going to be pepper jack cheese. No jalapenos in it because the jalapenos are already in your cheese. But if you were making jalapeno sausage or jalapeno cheese sausage, your jalapenos would go in right now because the grinder is going to do all your mixing for you. You don't need to worry about having to dice up jalapenos to tiny, tiny little pieces, because the grinder would take care of all that. I learned this from a good friend of mine. Like I said, the one who told me, "You want to add some mustard seed?" He taught me this, and he's taught a lot of people over the years. He's the most experienced sausage maker I know. That's the way he does it. It's the way I do it. I'm passing his knowledge that he taught me on to you. I've seen him make 1,000 pounds of sausage in one day. I've helped him make 1,000 pounds of sausage in one day. And that's from grinding all the way to having a finished product ready to be vacuum sealed. 1,000 pounds. All right, we're all ready to grind. One thing you always want to do with your grinder, at least an hour before you start to grind, throw your parts into a freezer. Let them get nice and cold, because as you're going through this, this grinder is going to heat up. It's going to have friction inside there. Parts are going to get hot. You don't want it to cook your sausage as it's grinding, and it will do it. I've actually, when you take this thing apart to clean it when it's done, you will see meat stuck to it that is almost baked onto its parts. So I always stick it in the grinder. I usually do it the night before, but at least an hour before you start, throw it in your freezer and let it get really nice and cold. All right, and also get yourself a dedicated grinder and a dedicated stuffer if you plan on doing this often. I used to have just a little grinder that had a stuffer attachment, grind and stuff. It'd take you all day. It's a whole lot better to invest. If you're going to do this regularly, invest in a good grinder, invest in a good stuffer. Keep those separate that way. And this is a Walton grinder. It's a commercial grinder. I went with Walton. I studied a bunch of different types of grinders when I was looking for one. I saw butchers make reviews about the Walton. This is a Walton number 32. There was a butcher that says he'd been using his every single day for the last 5 years. And if it's good enough for a butcher, then it's good enough for us. So we'll get it going. There we go. Okay, so we'll start grinding this. Like I said, it's all mixed up, ready to go now. And this big Walton number 32 will literally go as fast as you can drop it. It'll grind it. Actually, one time, making sausage out of a wild hog, and gave some to my father-in-law, and he brought me back a bullet the next day. And was like, here, you might want this back. I was like, what is this? He said, a bullet that actually went through the grinder, and it cut the bullet up. Never stopped. Just kept on going. I still have that chunk of bullet somewhere that it's just a little piece. You could see it perfectly sheared off. Didn't do one thing to my grinder. And as you can see, it's mixing beef, pork, everything together. And then we're going to do a double grind anyway. This is our first grind. We're going to send it back through the grinder again. And by that time, all the seasoning will be perfectly mixed. The beef and the pork will be mixed. And we didn't make ourselves exhausted trying to mix the two. We just finished the first grind. There's still meat in the barrel of this grinder. So to get that out, there's two ways that I know of. One is bread. You can run bread through it. It'll clean it out. What I always do, though, is I use ice. The only thing with ice, sometimes it'll literally freeze up inside the barrel and it can stop your grinder. So you want to just add it a little at a time. And you can see it's pushing the sausage out. The reason I use ice is because we're going to add water to this before we stuff it. So of course, this ice isn't going to do anything that the water is not going to do. Also, earlier I was telling you when to add jalapenos. You add the jalapenos before you grind. If you're going to do any type of cheese, you do not run it through this grinder. If you do, you will not have cheese sausage. It will completely disappear and you will never find it in the meat. You might find little tiny pieces every now and then, But for the most part, you will not have cheese in your sausage. So cheese is the last thing that gets added to this with the water right before we stuff. All right, so looks like all the meat has basically come out, and we can go ahead and do our second grind, which I won't bore you by filming, but we're gonna grind this one more time, then put it into the fridge until later tonight when we're ready to stuff. All right, guys, now we're gonna show you how to get your casings prepped. Now, there are several different types of casings out there. These are natural hog casings, basically hog intestines that have been cleaned out. They come packed in salt. Now, there's also collagen casings, which are basically fake casings that anybody worth their salt that makes sausage does not use a collagen casing. You want to use a natural casing. Now, there are exceptions to that rule. Summer sausage, if you ever notice that little plastic stuff that comes off of it, that's not a natural casing. So, but these are natural casings. They, to me, cook up better, a lot less problems with collagen or natural casings. So they are, like I said, they are packed in salt. These right here, this package will do 120 pounds of sausage. We're doing 100, so this should be plenty. Just like you can tell, this is just pure salt packed in there, salt and water basically. Let's say I only had to make 40 pounds of sausage. I could always, when I'm done, take this, pack it full of salt again, add a little bit of water, throw it in a Ziploc bag or my vacuum sealer bags, and store it, and it'll be good for the next time. So if you don't use all of them and you want to save them, just grab some salt, pack it, or you'll probably pour like half a can of salt just to get it right again. So, but anyway, we have to get all this salt off of them before we do it. We're about 8 hours away before we're going to do any stuffing, so I go ahead and do it now. That way, when we do start stuffing, they're ready to go. So just take me a pot here and just need hot water, and you're just going to start spraying them and try to get the salt off, basically just washing them. Now, you'll see this red plastic ring. That is, they tie it around the ring so you don't lose, you know, that way you can kind of somewhat keep it from becoming one big knotted mess. It is going to knot up on you. Don't fret. Just as you pull these, when you go to stuff in, you're going to pull one, work it all the way out until you get the knot out, and it happens every time. I've never done sausage and not had them knot up on me. So you just constantly keep dumping the water. Put fresh hot water back on it. Hot water from the sink. Don't use boiled water or anything like that. One time I told one of the guys here, I was like, hey, pour some hot water on those casings so when you start to clean them. Wasn't paying attention. He didn't know any better. He put hot water straight from the coffee machine. And when I realized what had happened, I ran over there and dumped the water out. Unfortunately, most of those casings were ruined because it basically half boiled them. And they were partially cooked, so couldn't use them because they would pop as soon as you tried to stick them on the stuffer. They would just tear. And you will see them start to rehydrate. They start out really, really dry, kind of wrinkly, but as you keep adding water and keep dumping it, because you're dumping all this salt out, and also what you want to do is once you've gotten most of the salt out, you're going to untie this knot or move the ring to a different place, because if you can see there on the knot where that was knotted up, it's dry and stuck together, so you definitely want to kind of let it get water everywhere and get the salt off of every spot, including that knot. You're just going to keep washing them. You do this over and over again. You can see the water is still gray from the salt. You just keep pouring the salt out. Keep adding fresh hot water. You do this over and over again. After I've done this probably about 10 times or better, it starts to look pretty fairly clean. The water is nice and clear. Then I'll let it sit here on the, I'll find a place to put it where it's not going to get bothered. And periodically throughout the day, I'll come and I'll add fresh hot water and just keep doing that all day long until we're ready to stuff. Now, some people, you will actually see them take the end of a casing and they will flush it out from the inside as well. I've seen people take water balloon, the things that you fill water balloons with, that you can add to a sink and then and flush it out like that. I used to do that. It's a pain in the butt. It really is. So, if you just constantly keep flushing it with fresh water over and over again throughout the day before you use it, it'll be fine. And then when I go to actually put these casings on the horn, on the stuffer, I'll put a little fresh water in it and then run it through that, run it through the horn. And you'll see that fresh water push all the way through the casing as you're sticking it on the horn until you have fresh water goes all the way through it. So that there's no need to do the water balloon thing where you stick it on there or stick it on the sink, because you will spend hours doing that. This is a whole lot easier, just constantly rinse, wash and rinse, wash and rinse. And you can see as I'm filling it, all these bubbles are coming from that salt. You just keep doing it over and over again until you get less and less bubbles. And the more you do it, the cleaner they'll get. And you can see they've kind of rehydrated now. They don't look like they did when they came out of that packaging. So basically right now, water's starting to look a little bit better here. I'm going to give it one more and then I'm just going to let these sit. I'll put them on a shelf somewhere, let them sit all day. Periodically throughout the day, I'll dump the water out of them and put fresh hot water, give them a rinse again, and leave them up on the shelf until we're ready tonight. I know a lot of people will do this the day before and let them sit, you know, all day or all night in the refrigerator after they've done the hot water for hours and hours, or throughout periodically like this. They'll stick them in the fridge before they go to bed. In the morning, they'll put fresh hot water on them again. That water's starting to look pretty clean. Doesn't look like there's much salt left. And you can see now, they don't look like they did when they came out of that, out of the packaging. They were all wrinkly and kind of almost dehydrated looking. Now they've rehydrated and look a whole lot better. So we're going to add more hot water on here and just set them on a shelf. And throughout the day, I'll keep rinsing them out, you know, periodically every hour or so until we need them tonight. All right, we're ready to start stuffing our sausage. As I said earlier, we have to add water before you run it through your stuffer. If not, if you try to run this through the stuffer right now, you are not going to be able to get it to come out this little horn. You can crank and crank. You're liable to break your stuffer because it's very difficult. So what you want to do is add ice cold water. If you don't have the benefit of a drink machine like we do, what you can do is take a cooler, put ice in it, then add water, and then get your water from that and add it to here because you want it to be cold. You don't want your sausage to get hot at all, your meat to get hot. So, And what you're looking for is almost like a meat slew. I mean, you're adding a lot of water. I know for a fact we're probably going to use this whole pitcher first. Then we're going to add cheese, and we'll probably have to end up adding more water. All right, I'm going to get my helpers here. This is Bert and Rose. They're going to mix this all up. It's nice to have a couple extra hands around. It doesn't take a lot of people to make sausage, but if you have a few people helping, it goes a whole lot faster. So you can see that meat is like soaking up that water. This isn't going to change your flavor. It's not going to, you know, thin it out. It's going to thin out the meat, make it easier to pump through the stuffer, but it's not going to change your flavors. All your seasoning's still there, and when you're smoking, that water is going to evaporate right out of the sausage anyway. You definitely want to have some big tubs like these. You can order them online. They call them meat lugs. Still pretty firm. All right. We're gonna add some more water. All right, so we can go ahead and add the cheese now. Like I said, never add cheese while you're grinding. After you grind, once you add your water, you can start adding your cheese. Your ratio for your cheese, this is 50 pounds of meat, so we're gonna put 5 pounds of cheese. So if you're doing 100 pounds, you're gonna need 10 pounds of cheese and so on. This is pepper jack cheese. This is one of my favorite recipes to run. I said earlier, if you're doing jalapenos, you would add it before you start to grind. Then you would add your cheese after the grind if you want to do a jalapeno cheese. With pepper jack cheese, jalapenos are already in it, so all you have to do is add your cheese as the last step before you stuff. Now, this is a high temp cheese. The reason it's called a high temp cheese, it can take a lot of heat before it starts to melt. When you put it in your put it in your smoker to start smoking, you don't have to worry about this cheese melting and just going all over or leaking out of your sausage, ending up on the floor. Now, a lot of people do use regular cheese. I personally don't. I've heard some bad stories of using it. Some people, though, also say that high temp cheese has a different flavor than regular cheese. I personally like it. My customers like it. I'll continue to use it. I've always used high temp cheese. The guy who taught me had told me a story of one time when he had first started experimenting with cheese. He put it into regular cheese in the sausage, and he stuck it in the smoker to smoke, and all his cheese ended up kind of puddling out onto the ends of the sausage the way he hung it, that it all leaked to the very ends. So he said that's when he found out about high temp, and he's used it ever since. Now, I've heard other stories like that before, but then I know of people that use regular cheese and don't have any problems. So I don't know. I just know I've always used high temp. Does it need more water? So after you add that cheese, it'll soak up a lot of water itself. What you're kind of looking for is you want it to get to the consistency where it's not so sticky anymore. Like you can kind of touch it and it doesn't stick to your glove or your hand. Some people wear gloves when they do sausage. I really don't, because once you start running it through the casing and everything, it gets kind of slick and it makes it harder to twist. It's easier for me to barehanded, just wash my hands real good before we start running any sausage. There are even some stuffers that you can hook up straight to a water hose, turn your water on, and it pumps water out as it's going through the stuffer. Those are really nice. Does it feel good or do we need more? It feels good? Yeah. All right. All right, so looks like it's ready. Got another helper here. This is my wife, Shelly. She likes to run the stuffer. She, right before we opened, we made 500 pounds of sausage, and she ran the stuffer for pretty much all 500 and kind of fell in love with doing this part. Our casings are ready from earlier today. They're completely hydrated. Salt's out of them. All I'm doing is undoing the knot around this little ring now. And I keep the ring on there just so I know I can always find the end of the casings. So this meat has been sitting in the fridge all day. It's ice cold. The water we add to it is cold. You want to keep your meat as cold as possible through this whole process. What she's doing now is wetting the horn so it's easier for the casings to slide on. So sometimes you'll find, it'll twist. You just have to kind of untwist it or take your time trying to get it on the horn. Before we got started, what we did is sanitize this whole area with, so we usually keep a bucket with sanitizer and a rag, wipe everything down before we get started. Keep towels, because it's going to get wet, because you got water, a lot of water inside this meat now. You're going to have water everywhere on your floors. All right. So as it's going to come down, you're going to see the fill up with air before it starts actually pushing meat out. And once you start getting pockets, stuff, you want to pop those with your knife, let some of that air out. So as she's cranking these out, they're going to spin this meat into a almost like a target shape, just a big circle, a big wheel of meat. So all they're doing is just kind of keeping it out of her way so it's not just falling everywhere. So you just roll it into a big ball. I've seen people take one of these big wheels. Oh, she had a pop. I never do that. So whenever that happens, you just cut it at the break. Throw the meat back into the tub and just run it again in the next run. Okay, so what you're going to do here, he's twisting the sausages. So we're going to go a little bit bigger, Bert. You go ahead, unroll that one. I wanted to go about an inch or two bigger than the normal sausages we've been rolling. Okay, so let's do them about that big. So what you're going to do on your first one, whatever direction you make that first turn, the next one has to be the opposite direction, because if not, you will untwist these. And what you want is your links to constantly twist. So this one, if you go that direction, Then the next one, you just kind of pinch the casing until you kind of make it like a little weak spot there, and then you can turn. You're just going to go the opposite direction. Now, some people, what they'll do is they'll skip this one and come, and they'll just keep spinning the same direction the whole time. And you see, I pop them every time I do that. So that's why I usually do one at a time. A lot of people are a whole lot faster than me when it comes to spinning or tying your links. But all you have to do is, if you pop one, cut it out, throw it back into your meat bucket, and you'll just run it later. There's no tying in this process. You'll see people tell you all the time, oh, you got to tie sausage, or I hate tying sausage. I never tie sausage, ever. Like, even if I do full links, these are what we call half links or short links. I never tie these. Even when I do a full link, I don't tie them either, because once you start smoking these casings are going to start to shrink. The water is going to evaporate out of the meat. They're going to shrink up and they're going to tighten up, and no meat's going to come out of it. See, and I, right there is a prime example. I went the wrong direction on that one. So it's backward on this one, forward on this one. And you just keep switching that process, and they'll tighten each other up. You want to get a few links ahead before they start cutting. And when they cut, all they're doing is they're just spreading the knot and then cutting it right on the knot. And you can see the end stays shut. And as it smokes, this casing is going to tighten up, and this meat's not going to come out. So there's no need to tie with string. I think people that tie with string have probably learned it from their grandfather, or have learned it from somebody who they've been doing it like that for years. There's no need to do it. You know, it's, unless you're going to hang them on a hook in your smokehouse and you need the string for that. But other than that, to me, it's just a waste of time. So you can see I'm just using my finger and kind of making a soft or weak spot right there. And that's where I'm going to try to do to spin it and make my knot. So you just kind of work that with your fingers and then spin it. And all you need is about two or three spins, because the next one you do is going to tighten that knot as well. So if you do two or three on the next one, you're going to end up with like six spins on one knot. And what I always do when I get to the end like this, you can see this would be a really long link. What I do is I just bend it in half, find the halfway point, and that's where I spin it. So you'll end up with two shorter links instead of two or one ginormous link. And then we just stack them back into a bucket or another bin. That bin is going to go into a refrigerator tonight. It'll sit in the refrigerator all night. And the reason we let it sit instead of going straight into the smoker is because by letting it sit in the refrigerator, it kind of dries it a little, the casing. And that'll give you a better color. It'll take the smoke better. If you put it on right now, you sometimes end up with a little bit lighter colored sausage. And we want that really pretty red or mahogany colored sausage. So that's why we let it sit in the fridge tonight, let these casings just kind of dry out on the outside of them. And then in the morning, we'll put them on the smoker. All right, guys, it's the next morning after we did our stuffing last night. Sausages have sat in the refrigerator. They're nice and cold, dries out that casing just a little bit so they can take a really good smoke. We got our fire going, not a huge fire, just I got a few pieces of wood, a little bit of charcoal underneath. That way we don't need a massive amount of heat. This pit is really large. It's a 500 gallon propane tank. This little bitty fire right here should stay under 200, about 200 to 225 most of the day. It's going to take us about 4 hours to smoke these sausages. We'll flip them halfway through, and you can see there that these casings look, they no longer look wet on the outside like they did yesterday after making them. They're just dried up just a little bit. This will help get a really pretty color to them. So we're going to load this sucker up. We'll run it for, like I say, about 4 hours, maintaining a 200 to 225 degree temperature. We're looking for a 150 internal temp of these sausages. That way we know they're fully cooked, and they can go ahead and get an ice bath and then be vacuum sealed and ready to go. So I'm going to load these up and we'll get going. This pit is so big, it doesn't have any slide outs, kind of the way I wanted it, but it's so big I have to almost lay down in it to reach the backside of it. Some people, this would be a huge problem because of the constant smoke and heat going in, but I'm around the fire and smoke all the time. It really doesn't bother me. But if you have a pit that has slide outs or you're not used to this, just be aware, sticking your head all the way into a pit can sometimes have make you cough or your eyes start to tear up. All right, guys, we're ready to pull the sausages off. They've been on for about 4 hours now. We flipped them halfway through, about the 2 hour mark. We've kept the fire basically under 250 degrees. Actually, we've been running about 225 to 200 is where we've been keeping it. Like I say, they've been on 4 hours. Oh. They look fantastic. They have a really pretty mahogany color. Get some gloves on, and I'll show you one of these. Take this one, and oh man, you can just see how all that juice and the cheese, they came out fantastic. Definitely really good. And one thing I forgot to mention to y'all yesterday, which is very, very important. Right before you stuff, you want to take some of your some of the sausage meat, make a little patty, throw it on the grill and taste it before you stuff. Because that's your last chance to add any seasonings that you might need to add to it. Because I've used this same recipe for hundreds of times. I've cooked thousands and thousands of pounds of sausage with that recipe. So I know the recipe. It never changes for me. Only thing that changes is whether I'm adding cheese or jalapeno and cheese. You know, but other than that, this is the exact same recipe I use for regular sausage, jalapeno and cheese sausage, pepper jack, done hatch and cheese. Everything's exactly the same. So my measurements, my weights, everything. So I know this recipe is going to come out the same way every time. But yeah, this is my favorite one, the jalapeno and cheese. I love the flavor of the cheese. It's not too spicy, so young kids can enjoy it. Yeah, to me, this is the best one out of all the ones I make. So what we're going to do now is we're pulling all of this sausage off and they're going to go immediately into an ice bath. I'm already set up in the inside the building. I've set up the bucket full of ice. Pull these off. We're going to go in there and dump them real quick. All right, guys, we brought the sausages in from off the pit. We have our ice bucket here. It's just ice and water. They're going straight in there, hot, and immediately dropping the temperature of them. The reason we're doing this, this brings them down extremely fast. It makes these casings really tight. They basically shrink real fast around your sausage. So then when you go to reheat these sausages, they will heat up, but that casing will snap. It'll give you a way better snap. Like, I don't know if you were able to notice when I took a bite out of that one outside, there's a little chew to it. Well, that chew is because it has yet to be dumped into these ice buckets. You always want to do this to really give your sausage a great snap. We're going to leave them in there about 15 minutes or so to really get that temperature below 40 degrees. And then as soon as we pull them, they'll be ready to vacuum seal and go right into the freezer. So what I'm going to do now is get another pot or bucket full of ice, dump it here on top. Then I'm going to go ahead and go start putting the next batch of sausage on the pit. While I'm doing that, I'm just going to let these sit. When I get done, I'll come back in here, pull these off, and they'll be ready to vacuum seal. And that's it. That's pretty much your whole process for making sausage. Go over just real quick a few things that I wanted to remind y'all of is always taste your sausage before you stuff it. Always use natural casings. Natural casings are way better than collagen. Keep your fire not too hot. You want to stay, depending on your pit. If you know here at the restaurant, I normally use a barbecue pit that we call Fat Amy. Fat Amy runs really hot. She's insulated. Takes very little wood to get her to 300 degrees or more. She can smoke sausage, but I tend not to use that pit because she's like a Ferrari. I mean, you give her just a little bit of gas and she's gone. So I use that big pit that we pulled these off of because that pit, I can put a big fire in there and it'll get up to 250. You know, it's a struggle to get it up to 300. So that pit's perfect for using for sausage making because I don't want to get over 225 degrees through the whole process. It takes about 4 hours. If you have a meat probe, you want to pull your sausage once it hits 150 degrees. You don't want to go any higher than that. It's fully cooked by then. If you're cold smoke, which cold smoking, you could stay at 100 degrees and go for hours and hours. Well, that sausage will never get to 150 degrees. So what you're going to want to do is always remember to fully cook that sausage before consuming it. Put it in the oven, put it on the pit, anything like that. These are all have reached 150 degrees internal temp. I could pull one out now and eat it or vacuum seal it and throw it in the fridge and just pull it out later and take a bite and it's not going to hurt you. But if you cold smoke, which that is an option, if you cold smoke, make sure you fully cook it before you consume it. So that's pretty much most of the highlights for making sausage. Give us a like on our page. Like and subscribe. If you have any questions, you can always reach out to me. I'll be glad to answer anything I possibly can. I've showed you exactly how I make sausage for the restaurant. I have no secrets when it comes to making barbecue sausage or anything otherwise. So if you ever have questions, feel free to reach out to us here at Damon's Real Texas Barbecue. Thank y'all for watching. Like and subscribe. God bless you. And remember, smoke meat, not meth. All right, guys, I have another quick tip for you. Just got these all loaded onto the pit. What I want to tell y'all is when you do put your sausage down, don't let them touch. The reason for that is you want the smoke to come in between each sausage link individually. If you end up letting them touch, once you go to flip them, you will see there will be a white spot. Whatever it touched will leave a white spot. That's why you flip them, because when we go to flip them in 2 hours, you will have little white checker marks from the grill. So that's why we flip them over, so that way we can get rid of those little white marks. So just make sure, don't let them touch. Don't try to pack them in there real tight. Make sure each one of them has their own space to breathe so that the smoke will come in between them.